because of the covenant of prayers and conduct to seeking your face you have given unto us. Lord, we thank you because there are millions and one programs going on upon the surface of the earth, but there are few that are documented in heaven. Lord, we thank you because among all the programs that have been conducted in the day, among all the programs that will be conducted in the month, among all the programs that is being conducted in the year, we thank you because the program of this evening is being documented. Lord, we want to worship your name because, oh God, we know for sure you are here with us and our guardian is unto thee. Lord, Father, we thank you because of how you have been reaching your children, and now you have been blessing, and now you have been transforming, and now you have been transfiguring. Father, we look up unto you this time around, give us life in Jesus' name. Blessed Father, we just humbly look up unto you. Our hope is in you, our desire is in you, our panting is after you, our yearning is unto you, our hunger is unto you. Lord, we pray this day, satisfy us by your power in Jesus' name. Eternal Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we look up unto you, O God, that wonders of your loaded in prayer. Mighty Father, in the name of Jesus, the great manifestations of your full pack in prayer. Eternal Father, in the name of Jesus, the wonderful ability that you have given unto a prayer man. Father, in the name of Jesus, the skillfulness in the spirit, the wonders of the demonstration in the spiritual realm, the ability more than, oh God, the physical things and more than the spiritual that they perform in the occult world that you have given unto men of prayer. The ability, oh God, that Father, in the name of Jesus, to maintain, oh God, double citizenship where the man kneels down before the living God, upon earth and is being recognized in heaven. Eternal Father, this day endow and endow upon everybody in Jesus' name. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, can we have the devil has covered the faces and they have created brows, that, oh God, that study cannot think, that the memory cannot peruse, that, oh God, the eyes cannot be able to see all the evil eyelashes. This day we pray, send them on fire in Jesus' name. Let the Father, in the name of Jesus, can the grace to come back again to the child. Father, in the name of Jesus, the energy again to come back again to the life. The power of the living God for the ears that are shaving from the ears of Samson to grow up again. And for energy, oh God, Samson to come back again as he gathered momentum and gathered energy. And rise up from where he's sitting, dust on the floor. We pray, send it down this day in Jesus' name. The flabby muscles of Samson that have been relaxing over some weeks and over some days. This day we pray, let the muscles, tendons, and the mountains, energies again reverberate in Jesus' name. Father, we look up unto you, to everyone of us, but the speaker, not the hearer, oh God, we pray in the name of Jesus, impact life in Jesus' name. This day, oh God, our Father, in the name of Jesus, can we plug ourselves to the light fire from heaven. Oh God, let there be transmission. Jesus' name we pray. Left to me, it is as if we should just go straight to prayer. But we have to make some little discussions. The GC told me that we have to make some little discussions, then we go to the Lord in prayer. God will help me to operate within the time to give you, and I know God will give us life in Jesus' name. We are considering the prayer heritage. I wish that I just don't stand in the front of the congregation and just be ministering. Why? Because I feel to be identified with the congregation. I just believe in the lifestyle of when you are discussing, you also come to the congregation, you participate in what you are telling them to do. You engage yourself in the assignment. So, though it will not be easy for me ethically to come and leave this place and join you, but friend, I'm fully with you. And I know God is going to give us life and give us transfiguration this day in Jesus' name. We are considering the prayer heritage. You see, there have been some wonders that exist upon the earth. And there are some of these wonders that give me unnecessary peruse. And one of the issues and matters that troubles my mind that have taken me to God in prayers is this matter of prayer heritage. And I strongly believe that God will help us as we reason together. We'll be able to find ourselves in the normal right track and have life in Jesus' name. Now we look at the word heritage. The question is that what do you mean by heritage? I didn't bother to check dictionary. I didn't bother to browse Google or whatever. But I just believe God himself will give you the definition. The heritage, the way I perceive it, is a virtue that had been inherited, or an inherited virtue needed to be preserved. Now, in application to the message we are considering, or to the prayer program we are having, more or less, prayer heritage. So, we have to look at it. Has there been any heritage on prayers that have been established already? Because that's the background.
When you look at this thing now, it's telling us that there's a kicking point that has been established. There's a reference, there's a foci. There is a point that something has been generated from that point. And without that point being established, we will not be able to go anywhere. We can't talk about prayer heritage if there's no reference, if there's no focus, if there's no foci, if there's no point we call the pole in geography. The pole is the point at which whatever reference you want to make upon the earth, you must make reference in accordance to that particular pole. If you want to call the location of Ife, the location of your hometown, the location of anywhere, you must say it alongside a particular line of Greenwich Meridian. It will be a reference point. Now, what we are saying is that, has there been a reference point when you come to the school of prayer? Has there been issues? Have there been points? Have there been a focus? Is there any cardinal points that we can stand and we plot ourselves, and when we plot ourselves, we make a reach to that particular point? And then we can now say that we are having a particular compass. Because without the reference point, we cannot claim that we are having a compass. But I want to tell you, my brethren, God has made provision enough for reference points. Which aspect are we going to pick it? If we want to pick it, looking at the church as a body, emanating from Christ Jesus himself, I'm talking to workers, so I possibly may not go into too much reading of the scriptures. You can look at the life of Jesus. It's a reference point. Now, we are dealing with prayer, so we look at him in the aspect of prayer. It's a reference point. The Bible says, only the brains of his own flesh make serious prayer of intercession unto God. With what? With strong cry. The Bible says, and it was hard because he feared. Again, the Bible tells us that when he was about to go to the cross of Calvary, he made serious prayer that nobody has ever made on earth. When you are talking of prayer, we can make reference to Job. We can make reference to Daniel. We can make reference to Ezekiel. We can make reference to Jeremiah. In short, we can make reference to Jacob when he was praying at Jabbok. It was a mighty prayer. But all those prayers cannot be likened to the prayers that Jesus Christ prayed when he was interceding. Preparation to go to the cross of Calvary. The man prayed, and when he was praying, he started sweating. You know, even before you sweat, heat will be coming out of your body. When heat will be coming out, then at a time, sweat will be coming out. Then at a time, the sweat of the body of Jesus Christ got exhausted. When the sweat got exhausted, it was so falling and so great that the value of the prayer, the vibration of the prayer, the re-intercession of the prayer, the way the muscles were shaking, the re-vibration that was coming from inside him, it was a panting prayer. The body has to still be issuing out certain things. So when the metabolic system could not find water again to produce, to release the waste product because of the prayer, it got to bounce on the water, I mean, or the liquid that it can find on the body. So he jumped on the blood. So either before Jesus got to the cross of Calvary, he had been shedding his blood for man's. And the first blood he shed was the blood of prayer. So he shed that blood, and the Bible said the water that was coming out of his body. Because the Bible cannot tell us in a direct, categorical way. Simple heart of man will not absorb it. In short, casual men will not swallow it. Christians cannot easily. I mean, casual believer will not be able to understand it. People are just lazy in the school of prayer, cannot be able to swallow it. I say, how can the Bible tell us and what Jesus was praying, he was releasing blood, and that his blood was being gushed out. Why? But my brother, sincerely, he was releasing blood. He was praying, he was interceding in a serious way. And so, the system of the body has to make use of the blood. And so, in the course of processing it, blood was released out. And the Bible now how to express it in a way that it would be easy for simple man to understand. He said, and the water coming out of his body was like the gushing out of blood. Now, we've seen a reference point. Jesus Christ has a reference point. When we want to make reference point even to the Bible, I've told you of some of the men of God who prayed. The Bible says Elijah was a man subject to like passion as well. Elijah could get afraid, you can't believe it. When he had the news that he's going to be killed by Jezebel, and he could recollect the numbers of prophets that Jezebel has masterminded to kill, can recollect all the havoc that that woman has done in the palace and that was thing that he has witnessed. He himself was afraid. He was so afraid that where he was, he took leave, he ran away. While he was, you know, Elijah was a man who was dynamic. When he was putting down fire, he ran a bypass horse. He got to a place of safety before even the horse rider could go there. So the servant of Elijah that was with him, his feet was faster because he was running for safety. Where am I going? When you talk in the school of prayer, are you claiming you are weak? Elijah also was weak. Apostle Paul also was weak. He said, well, who is weak that I'm not weak? Who is this and I'm not this? Who is that and I'm not that? But my brother, now having established this reference point, we now come to the heritage of prayer. That's the focus point that we are looking at. I believe as we call upon the Lord, God will show us mercy. He will answer our prayers in Jesus' name.
Let's open our Bible to the book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 49. The scepter shall not depart from Judah. I read from verse 10. Genesis chapter 49, verse 10. The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet, until Shiloh come, and unto him shall the guardian of the people be. Now, if you look at that particular place, you now have to think, what was the scripture saying in this place? What was the message that God is trying to pass across? The Bible said the scepter shall not depart from Judah. The scepter means the power of authority, the rod of command. The Bible says it shall not depart from Judah. Now, in this particular place, Judah was still alive, but there was a command given to him and given to his lineage, given to his generation, that the scepter shall not depart from Judah. That the scepter of authority, the power, the lordship, the instruction, all things you can make mention of when you come to ability and power can be referred to as scepter. Now the Bible says, shall not depart from Judah, nor the lawgiver from between his feet, until Shiloh come. And unto him shall all the guardian of the people be. In this particular place, a heritage has been formed. Judah has been recognized as somebody who has been able to pioneer something tangible. And after this, a power was attached to him, and a blessing was made upon him. And based upon this blessing, based upon this proclamation, it has been documented. As far as the history of Israel is concerned, the scepter shall not depart from Judah. Now, bringing this home and applying it to us, the prayer heritage. We have heritage of prayers here. And I strongly believe that God, in his mercy, in his compassion, will not allow this prayer heritage to disappear in our midst and in our lives in Jesus' name. Looking at the message, well, we call it message or the discussion before the prayer, maybe we'll subdivide it into about three or four sections. One, we look at the possibility of prayer gene. When you talk of gene, that is the trait that can be passed from one generation to the other. The biologists, you understand that better. The possibility of prayer gene. We look at the second point, the plausible and the dominant gene, that is the legible, the plausible and the dominant gene. Then we look at the passing and the extinct gene. The passing and the extinct gene. And finally, we look at the resuscitating. To resuscitating the dormant gene. Resuscitating the dormant gene. We look at the first thing, the possibility of prayer gene. Now let's go into simple discussions about this thing.
My brethren, you see, I have taken time to look at some things sometimes ago. And you gave me a great shock. And up till now I'm praying on it. When you look at some words, you see the manifestations of some genes that could be found, either physical or spiritual or in the aspect of sport or in some other aspects, you see those genes, some of those genes, biologically now, they may not really be worthy of reference, but these are traits that we can find in somebody who is a maybe progenitor or a father or whatever. We see it manifesting in the children. And this is a great thing that comes for you to think. As you look at that, let's see how what the scriptures get to say. Let's open our Bible to the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2. I read from verse 10. For it became him, for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons unto glory, including daughters, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. Now you have this question: who have brought many sons unto glory in this particular place? Is Jesus Christ. Am I talking sense? I read further. For both he that sanctified, that Jesus, and they who are sanctified, that is yourself and myself, are all of one. For which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren. That place make it simple for you to understand that Jesus Christ, being the Lord, being the Master, he will sanctify the believers, bring many sons and daughters, I mean, in this kingdom of God, and he identifies himself as a brother with us. In other words, we are of the same family. Now I read further. Saying, I will declare thy name unto my brethren. In the midst of the church will I sing praise unto thee. And again, I will put my trust in him. And again, behold, I and the children which God has given me are for what? Yes. Because that scripture was quoted from a place. Are for signs and what?